Good morning. Welcome to Redeemer Parish's Sunday morning worship service. We are certainly glad that you've joined us today. If you haven't done so yet, please go to the church website, redeemercannonsburg.org. Click on the media tab and download today's worship bulletin so you can follow along. While you're doing that, I'd love to tell everyone that our dear friend Harry Ladley will be celebrating the 25th anniversary of his ordination is this coming Friday, and several of the songs that we'll be singing today were sung at his ordination, and he requested that we put these in, and we were happy to do so. So congratulations to you, Harry. We love you. 25 years being ordained, great accomplishment. We will now stand together as we sing our opening hymn. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
We pray together, Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. We say together the Pascha Nostrum. Alleluia. Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Alleluia. Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia. Christ has been raised from the dead and the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Alleluia. We sing together.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated for the first lesson.
Our first lesson this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 17. Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, and that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, 'For we are indeed his offspring.' Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of men. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, 'We will hear you again about this.' So Paul went out from their midst. But some men joined him and believed, among whom also were Dionysius the Areopagite and a woman named Damaris, and others with them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We'll read together Psalm 148, verses 7 through 14, responsibly by half verse. Praise the Lord upon earth,
you sea monsters and all deeps,
fire and hail, snow and fog,
wind and storm fulfilling his word,
mountains and all hills,
fruitful trees and all cedars,
beasts and all cattle,
creeping things and birds of the air,
kings of the earth and all peoples,
princes and all rulers of the world,
young men and maidens,
old men and children together.
Let them praise the name of the Lord.
For his name only is excellent, and his praise above heaven and earth.
He shall exalt the horn of his people, all his faithful shall praise him.
The children of Israel, the people who are near him, praise the Lord. Our epistle lesson is from 1 Peter chapter 3. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand and sing with me. Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Pray with me. Father, I ask as we open your word today that we would learn what it looks like to live in a morally and ethically challenged world that is opposed to you on so many fronts. I ask you would open our hearts and minds to receive your word today, and I ask it in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. During China's Boxer Rebellion in 1900, insurgents captured a mission station. They blocked all the gates but one, and in front of that one gate, they placed a cross flat on the ground. The word was then passed to those inside that any who trampled on the cross underfoot would be permitted their freedom and their lives, but that any who refused would be shot. Terribly frightened, the first seven students trampled the cross under their feet and were allowed to go free. But the eighth student, a young girl, refused to commit the sacrilegious act. Kneeling beside the cross in prayer for strength, she arose and moved carefully across the cross, around the cross, and went out to face the firing squad. Strengthened by her example, every one of the remaining 92 students followed her to the firing squad. My friends, we're in the first epistle of St. Peter today, chapter 3, verses 8 through 18, and Peter is again writing to a beleaguered group of Christians in the Asia Minor region, what we now call modern-day Turkey. He's writing to those who've faced persecution for their faith, and he's trying to give them hope on how to live. He's trying to tell them how to live ethically and how to live morally in what is a sinful and often hostile world. And he opens his writing today, opens our passage today in verses 8 through 12, talking about the ethics for living in a sinful world. Let me read it. "Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind." The first thing that Peter gives to his audience is ethics about how to live in a messy church. Before we can worry about how to live in a sinful and hostile world, let's first establish how it is we're supposed to live together in a messy church. He says that you should have unity of mind, the idea of harmony. It's not uniformity, but it's unanimity. Peter is not telling us and his audience in Asia Minor, he's not telling them that they all have to be the same, that they all have to be uniform, but that they must be unanimous. They must be together. He tells them to have sympathy, both compassion and understanding for those that suffer and for those that suffer differently from them. Compassion and sympathy. Sympathy is sometimes hard to muster, isn't it? You look at someone who's suffering and you think, well, they brought that on themselves. Maybe they did or maybe they didn't. That's not really relevant. It doesn't change that we are commanded to have sympathy for those who suffer. He tells them to have brotherly love. Love one another as good neighbors. Love one another. Seek what is best for one another. Maybe you can imagine your own neighborhood and what it takes to make good neighbors. Now, I know there's that saying, high fences make good neighbors, but I don't really think that's true. High fences just make neighbors who don't know each other. But what does it mean to be a good neighbor? What does it mean to put restrictions on yourself so as to not insult or offend your neighbor? What does it mean to show kindness to them, perhaps to get their mail or pressure wash their fence for them or to do something to help them out, to seek what is best for them instead of always what is best for yourself? That's what it means to be a good neighbor. He commands them to have a tender heart and a humble mind. Seek first what is best for one another, not holding ourselves or our opinions too highly. And so in this first opening sentence, Peter gives us then some ideas about what it means to live ethically with one another. Humbly, with humility, compassion, and seeking harmony. Seeking to be peacemaker. Seeking to build bridges instead of build walls. It's not always going to be easy. Sometimes we're going to live in a hostile culture, though none of us have ever experienced what this young student experienced during the Boxer Rebellion. None of us here, I don't think, have experienced anything like that. It's possible that someday we will. And it is also likely that in some way, almost every day, you're getting some kind of pushback or hostility or hearing some kind of hostility toward the things of Christ and the teachings of Christianity. And so we have to adopt sort of an image for living in a hostile culture. First, we brotherly kindness and humility and sympathy toward one another. But what do we do with those on the outside? Well, it goes without saying that those same principles that work inside the church, that we're called to do that outside of the church. But Peter goes a step further and he says, "Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. When you find yourselves living in a hostile situation, perhaps a hostile relationship or a hostile culture, when you find yourself under pressure, people coming after you, he says to them, look, don't repay evil for evil, reviling for reviling. Reviling means abuse. Don't go tit for tat. Don't go toe to toe. Don't seek to get back what is yours. Don't seek revenge. Don't seek revenge. I had a college friend who is probably to this day the most revengeful person that I know. He was a master at getting back at people. A couple of the things he did in college, one was relatively harmless and funny. The other was a little not so much. He went to our school's computer lab, and back in those days, in the early 90s, we rarely had laptops, and few of us had desktops, but computer labs in the college were a bigger deal than I think they are now, and you would go to the computer lab to do your work. And there was a student on our campus that had a very nice sports car, and instead of parking in the parking lot, in the parking spot, he decided to drive up the very wide handicap ramp and park on the sidewalk right in front of the doors, which is a very dumb college student thing to do. Well, my friend saw this and, being very irritated by it, took out his pocket knife and cut the valve inflation, the tire inflation valves on the back two tires. He didn't puncture the tires, he cut the little air valves. And it let all the air out on two tires so that he couldn't just put a spare on. He had to call a tow truck. And it's like a $4 repair. So it wasn't lasting damage, but it was devious and it was revengeful. This same guy, we were in an athletics dorm together. And the football players, during spring practice, had to go out for practice at 4:30 in the morning. And those guys decided that if they were going to be up at 4:30 in the morning, all of us in the dorm were going to be up at 4:30 in the morning. And so as they were going out, they went yelling down the hall, pounding on all of our doors to wake all of us up. So we had to be up with them. And my friend decided he was going to get back at them. This is back in the days of dial-up modems, AOL and Prodigy, you know, the height of technology. At that day, we didn't think it could get any better than that. Well, he set the modem on his computer to dial the phone numbers of all of those football players' rooms. You see, the hallway, if you picture a long hall, half of the hall were non-athletes. The other half of the hall were the football players. And the phone numbers in those days in the dorms were in sequence. So if you knew the number at the first room, you knew the number for every room after that. And so he told his computer modem to dial each number one at a time, starting at midnight. And it rang all of the rooms on that side of the hall. And when the guys got up, picked up the phone, they heard that annoying modem sound. They'd hang up, it would dial the next one, dial the next one. And when it got to the end of the hall, it started over. And it dialed, and it dialed, and it dialed. To this day, I've never met anyone who was as good at getting back as someone as this guy. He was a genius when it came to revenge. And he's a good guy, so I don't mean to disparage him. I'm simply saying, Peter is telling his people, when folks are doing evil to you, when they're reviling you, don't seek to get revenge. That is not actually going to help the situation. On the contrary, bless them. Now, have you ever had somebody really upset with you, treating you poorly, and you decided to openly say, I forgive you, I don't hold this against you, to openly forgive them? Most of the time, the person you're forgiving has no idea how to even handle that. They're ready for a fight, and instead they're met with blessing. And usually, it diffuses the situation. So he says, don't be eager for revenge. And there's a quotation here. He quotes from Psalm chapter 34. And in this psalm, there are several imperatives, and I'm not going to walk through them all. But the idea would be this. Let me read it first. For whoever desires to love life and to see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And so as Peter's explaining to his readers, this is how you live in a hostile world. He goes back to this Old Testament psalm and he says, look, Echoing the words of Jesus, it echoes, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." Paul says, "If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all." It is in the heart of God that his people are supposed to be peacemakers. That is true in the Old Testament and it's true in the New. And our psalm tells us that one of the reasons why we do this is because God is watching. And if it is in the heart of God that his people are supposed to be peacemakers, he will know when we are not. And the people who live their lives stirring up controversy, trying to seek revenge, being generally people who tear down rather than build up, there will be no blessing for those folks. God blesses those who follow after his heart, and his heart is a heart of peace. And so God reserves special blessing for those who seek peace, not peace at any cost. There are lines that Jesus tells us we shouldn't cross, and Paul tells us lines we shouldn't cross. So it isn't peace at any cost, but it is peace whenever possible. Peace whenever possible. Seek first those things. Let God work out the rest. And so verse 13, Peter picks up, "Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ, the Lord, as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect." Anchor your ethics in the gospel. Anchor your reasons for doing good, treating others with respect. Anchor those things in the gospel. Peter says in verse 13 that there's a very practical reason for this. People who are living in a hostile world, if they can convince others that they're really there to help, that they're really there to do good, that has the tendency of lowering the level of hostility. That has a tendency to win people over. When you're seen as a person seeking the general good and welfare of others, then folks are far less likely to attack you or malign you or persecute you. However, he says, we do not live in a sort of naive world, that if I'm just a nice person, everyone will be nice to me. No, in fact, Christianity teaches quite the opposite, that there are, in fact, people in the world who are committed to serving evil. And there are people in the world who will seek to harm you. They will seek to persecute you no matter what you do. And so our stance on hope has also been baptized in realism. We will sometimes, no matter our actions or intentions, run afoul of people intent to do us harm. And yet, in the second half of verse 14, he says, "You will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled." Have no fear. How can he say that? How can Peter say to his people, who like this little girl in China almost 100 years ago, like her, they're faced with a life and death decision. To follow Jesus may well mean that I get killed, or I could take an easier road. And he says to them, "Do not fear, but be brave and be full of peace, and do not be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy." So, what is the key to thriving in the midst of hostility? And I actually think Peter gives us two keys, and we find them in verse 15. "But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you." There are two keys there. The first is your inward attitude. Always honor Christ as holy. Author and theologian Scott McKnight says, "We are to acknowledge as holy the Lord himself and refuse to profane his name or breach his covenant with us by fearing someone else more than him." We need to know who bought us with a price. We need to know to whom we belong. And we belong to our Lord Jesus Christ. And Peter says one of the keys to surviving in a hostile world, in a place where people are against you and against your Savior, is you honor that Savior in your inner attitude. You put him first in your heart before anything else. You seek inwardly to please him more than you seek to please others. You care more about his opinion of you than you care about anyone else's opinion of you. And so there is an inward attitude. That's the first key to successful thriving in a hostile world. An inner attitude of honoring Christ. But it doesn't just stop with the inner. It also expresses itself in an outward witness. And so we have an inner attitude and an outward witness. This is a constant willingness to speak up for Jesus and express our confidence in him despite the practical consequences. We are exhorted to know what we believe, why we believe it, and don't be afraid to say so. Now, this doesn't necessarily mean we need to be a people who every word out of our mouth is about Jesus. This isn't necessarily what it means. It simply means this: when you are pressed because you are a Christian, don't shilly-shally. Don't muddle the truth. Don't waver. Speak clearly about what you believe. Speak clearly about why you believe it. And if you have sheltered an honor for Jesus in your inner self, it will be easier to express that outwardly. And so you have an inner attitude that expresses itself in an outward willingness to speak up for the things of Christ, even if you're the only one that is willing to do so. I remind you of our little girl in China. She was not the first student to go out that door. There were seven that went before her. And her courage sparked all of the rest to remain courageous, to remain firm. Sometimes you're going to think, I'm the only one. If I speak up here, other people are going to ridicule me. And they may. In fact, it's probable that they will. But it is just as likely that others will be inspired by your message. Now, you may say to me, Eric, that's kind of extreme. Like, none of us are being told to renounce Christ or we're going to be put before a firing squad. And that is true. In our current context, I am assuming most of you viewing this are in the United States. Nobody is making us do this sort of thing or make this kind of decision. However, there are subtle mockeries that do make life difficult. Here's a story from history that you might resonate with. There were once some archaeologists who were digging in the remains of a school for imperial pages in Rome, and they found a picture dating to the first century. It's actually a little carving made in clay. It's almost like stick figures drawn in clay. If I could show you a picture, I would. It really looks like a kid drew it. It shows a boy standing, his hand raised, worshiping a figure on a cross. A figure that looks like a man, but has the head of a donkey. Scrawled in the writing of what definitely looks like a young person's handwriting, it says this: Alexemenos worships his god. Nearby, they found another inscription that says, Alexemenos is faithful. Almost everyone agrees that whoever this young page was in this school in ancient Rome, that his classmates were mocking him for being a Christian, drawing pictures of a Jesus that has the head of a donkey, blaspheming Jesus, and mocking this young man. That is the sort of thing that has happened to many of us. It is the sort of thing that will likely happen to us again. It's the sort of thing that happens to children today. This is not persecution of the same sort as our little girl in China and as our brothers and sisters in many places of the world face. But that doesn't mean that it's easy. It doesn't mean that it's easy to be the only one in a workplace, the only one in a household, the only one in a school who's willing to say, I follow Jesus. It's not easy to do that. It's not easy to be that person. And Peter's message for you is the same as his message for those who are being persecuted with violence. And that is, you have a hope within you. And that hope that is in you should be spurring you to courage. Courage to always have an answer. Courage to honor Jesus Christ. And courage to not worry what other people are going to say or think. And you know what I found in my own life? I found in my own life that the more winsomely bold that I am, the less people take offense. Now, look what Peter says, and I'll get back to that point. Look what Peter says to his people. He says to them, be willing to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Gentleness and respect. I've blown it many times. I've gotten upset. I've gotten defensive. I've gone after someone, and the conversation didn't end well. But I've also found that on those times when we just have a friendly, civil, honest exchange of ideas, that you really can make your point and defend your beliefs without making people angry. And so if people are getting excessively angry with you because of your Christian witness, I would ask you to check yourself, because maybe it's you. Maybe it's not your message. Maybe it's how you're presenting it. And so Christians, in other words, are expected to be prepared to speak at any moment about God's salvation of his people through Jesus Christ and how that salvation will manifest itself in the end of history. The very hope that sustains them through persecution and gives them strength to carry on when everything else looks so dismal. Be ready to tell people why you're a Christian. Know what you believe. Know why you believe it. And don't be afraid when asked or pressed to say so. It may be hard, but it won't be worse than denying your Savior. And so hope references here that final glory that we will receive when we come to Jesus. And then Peter ends our passage with this. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Even though our text in English says for, the beginning of verse 18 actually is because. Honor Christ, be ready to give an answer, because Christ also suffered for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. The honor that we hold in our hearts and the gospel we proclaim is not for a normal man, not a good teacher or a sports hero, but for the Son of God made flesh, who suffered evil for doing good. He not only suffered for doing good, he suffered for those who did evil. He suffered by putting on death for us so that we might put on life. Honor this Jesus in your inner self. Reflect him in your outer attitude. And you'll find in time that courage in the face of trials and hope in the darkness will both grow in you. And these things that will grow in you cannot be extinguished. And so, my friends, I want to encourage you today that there is a way to be in this world where you can thrive, honor Christ, and be ready to give an answer. And the Christ who and God who sees all, who blesses all, will see you. And he may not spare you from suffering in the here and now. But our great hope is that Jesus died so that the justice of God would be fully served when his timing is ready. And so, friends, do not be afraid. Be brave. Be strong, be ready to give an answer, and do it for the sake, for the glory and the honor of Jesus Christ our Savior. Father, I ask that you would sink this truth deep into our hearts, that we would become inspired to live for you in our inner self and in our outer self. Make us, Lord, into the kind of Christians that are not afraid, but the kind of Christians who are willing to follow you anywhere. And I ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, friends, I invite you to stand as we will say together the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 7 in your bulletins. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now I invite you to kneel for the prayers of the people.
At this time, let us pray for the church and for the world. O God, the creator and preserver of all, we humbly pray for all sorts and conditions of people, that it would please you to make your ways known unto them and your saving health unto all nations. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
More especially, we pray for the Holy Church throughout the world, that it may be so guided and governed by your good Spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we remember before you those who suffer want and anxiety from lack of work. Guide the people of this land so to use our public and private wealth that all may find suitable and fulfilling employment and receive a just reward for their labor through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, whose Son had nowhere to lay his head, grant that all who live alone may not be lonely in their solitude, but that following in his steps they may find fulfillment in loving you and their neighbors. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O God, who created all peoples in your image, we thank you for the diversity of races and cultures in this world. Show us your presence in those who differ from us and enrich our lives with fellowship until our knowledge of your love is made perfect in our love for all your children. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Increase, O God, the spirit of neighborliness among us, that in peril we may uphold one another, in suffering tend to one another, and in homelessness, loneliness, or exile, befriend one another. Grant us brave and enduring hearts that we may strengthen one another until the disciplines and testings of these days are ended, and you again give peace in our time. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
At this time, I invite your own prayers and intercessions.
Father, we thank you for our friend Harry celebrating the 25th anniversary of his ordination this week. I pray that his day would be a good day. I pray too, Father, for those going back to work, for those who are now seeking employment, that as our economy, as our state begins to open up, that they would be able to find meaningful work again. I pray for those dealing with anxiety because of the COVID-19. I ask, Father, that you would calm their hearts, that they would have a sense of peace and a sense of your presence. Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And now all who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and seek to live in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God as you devoutly kneel. We pray together.
Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker and judge of us all, we acknowledge and repent of our many sins and offenses, which we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Greet your loved ones with signs of God's peace. Well, again, thank you so much for turning into our service today. Please don't forget, giving to your parish, your home church, is greatly appreciated. And please recall, too, as we open up, as we have new opportunities to minister, be mindful of where God might have you go and who he might have you meet and whom he might have you speak with. There's a lot of work to be done for the kingdom, and we're finally going to get back to being able to do some of that, and I'm excited for it. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. We will now sing together our offertory hymn.
I have heard my people's cry.
Hear what St. Paul says. For this reason I bow my knees before the Lord, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of his glory he may grant you to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we can ask or imagine, according to his power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please kneel. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Let us pray these words together. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are spiritually present in the sacrament of Holy Communion. I love you above all things, and I desire your presence within my soul. And since I cannot now receive the bread of heaven and the cup of salvation, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray together. Soul of Christ, be my salvation. Body of Christ, my consecration. Blood of Christ, fill all my veins. Water from Christ's side, wash my stains. Passion of Christ, my comfort be. O good Jesus, listen to me. Within your words I long to hide, nor to be parted from your side. O guard me when the foe assails me. Guide me when my feet shall fail me. Bid me come to you above, with all your saints to sing your love, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and remain with you always. Amen. We sing together our closing hymn. Alleluia, alleluia. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thank you for coming.